Donner la parole à ma collègue le professeur Berkveld, qui est bien connu dans le monde, je dirais, de l'histoire des musées, pour avoir coordonné une entreprise européenne de naissance, sur la naissance des musées en Europe, une autre sur l'histoire des musées napoléoniens, et qui va nous présenter une communication en anglais sur l'histoire au Rijksmuseum d'Amsterdam. Floor is yours.
Thank you very much, organizers of this marvelous 3 days, for inviting me and having the opportunity to pay tribute to Professor Pomian. My paper will about three cases. History in the Rijksmuseum. I will discuss three cases. One 19th century picture about the Battle of Waterloo on the left, one 17th century picture with a swan, and 18th century weapons in the middle, 18th century weapons that were thought to have belonged to the 17th century Admiral Michiel de Ruyter. But I'll start with the largest picture in the Rijksmuseum, 8 meters wide. This picture and the room in which it is exhibited, the Waterloo Room, was the reason that the Frenchman Dominique Moissy criticized the Dutch chauvinism in the reopened Rijksmuseum. According to Moissy, the old Rijksmuseum had been a celebration of the universal qualities of Dutch painters like Rembrandt and Vermeer. But now, after the reopening of the museum in 2013, at least according to Moissy, the museum is a chauvinist celebration of Dutch art and Dutch history. As an example, he mentions this room, and indeed, the major change in the new Rijksmuseum is that the strict division that was there between the art department and the history department has disappeared. And indeed, the Waterloo Room is now one of the rooms with a mixed presentation, as you can see. There are pictures, there are guns, there's porcelain and musical instruments, so a mixed presentation. I'll show you this room quickly. So the first thing you see when entering this room is a portrait of Napoleon Bonaparte. And then the other rulers of the Netherlands in the 19th century, Louis Napoleon, a brother of the emperor. He was the first king of Holland. And then you see William I, the first Dutch king. On the other walls, the emphasis is on Louis Napoleon and his cultural policy. He started the Prix de Rome in Holland for young artists whose works are on the walls. Moreover, Louis Napoleon moved the National Museum from The Hague to Amsterdam and ordered loans from the city of Amsterdam as Rembrandt's Night Watch to be presented in his museum. And he also started the Dutch salons after the example of the Parisian salons. Louis Napoleon's Royal Museum was one of the predecessors of the Rijksmuseum. And here, more Italian influences, and here we are back to the Battle of Waterloo. And some more images in which you can see the mixed presentation. So according to me, this room is not so much about Dutch chauvinism, but mainly about the French period in Holland. We even were for 3 years part of the French Empire, as can be seen in the portrait of Napoleon Bonaparte. And it's also about the French and Italian influences on Dutch art. So I'm afraid that our French visitor, Moissy, looked only at the large Pinneman picture and only saw that Napoleon was being defeated and did not see the rest of the room. Shocking for him, and perhaps also for other French people, it depicts a battle where Napoleon was defeated, indeed. However, On this picture, not a Dutch hero is the main character, but the Duke of Wellington. He's in the middle, and he is the hero of this picture. And indeed, the future king of the Netherlands, the later King William II, is also depicted, but he is a subordinate figure on the left. If it is a celebration, it's a celebration of the clever general whose allied European forces defeated Napoleon. The Duke of Wellington is the real hero. This picture was painted by Pieneman, the painter Pieneman, for the free market. It was not a commission. Pieneman traveled a long time with this picture around in England and asking a fee from the visitors to see the exhibition. We assume that Pieneman had hoped that Wellington would buy the picture. That in the end did not happen. But King William I finally purchased it for a large amount of money. And it was placed in Haarlem in the National Museum for Living Masters. Just like the other two national museums at the time, the Rijksmuseum in Amsterdam and the Mauritshuis in The Hague, it was an art museum and not a history museum. Pieneman's picture was also seen there as a work of art. We can deduce that from the correspondence when 50 years after Dutch independence was to be celebrated in 1863. In that year, the keepers of the museum in Haarlem asked whether they were allowed to decorate Pieneman's picture with Dutch flags. They wanted to emphasize the picture and the battle on it and its contribution to Dutch independence 50 years before. But the board refused. They said this tribute was not appropriate in a public museum. They said that Pieneman's picture was a great work of art and it would be a shame to spoil it with flags. So according to the board, this was an artwork. But the museum staff thought that it was about history. And now a Frenchman sees something completely different in it than a Dutch art historian, than me. Mazzi sees now primarily Napoleon's defeat, and so he sees Dutch triumphalism. But I see British superiority in the context of the Netherlands in a period of a very bad economy, one of the worst in Dutch history, and also artistically it was a very bad time as well. And I also see that Louis Napoleon did a lot to improve that bad artistical situation. Now I'll give you some background on our Dutch national museums. First, some general remarks. At the time, the art museums were primarily schools for artists, not for the general public. And anyhow, there was not much money available, not for the art, let alone for the history. And that's the third point. History was of minor importance in the 19th century. Now, an overview of the four buildings in which the Rijksmuseum was housed. It started in The Hague, in the National Art Gallery, in Huis ten Bosch, House in the Wood, that was a former palace of the family of Orange. Then Louis Napoleon moved the collection to Amsterdam, to his Royal Museum, and Royal Museum was the former Amsterdam Town Hall. Then it moved to the Trippenhuis, which was the largest canal house at the time, and it was called the Rijksmuseum, so National Museum. And in the end, only in the end of the 19th century, there was enough money to build a very large building, and that was opened in 1885. But back to the National Art Gallery, the time of the Batavian Republic, which was a sister republic of the French one. The French and the Dutch patriots had ended the Ancien Régime of the family of Orange as stadtholders and the Republic of the Seven United Provinces. And the family of Orange had fled to England, and the Orange collection of pictures and nature had been taken by the French armies to Paris. The nature is still in the Muséum National d'Histoire Naturelle, never came back, but many of the stadtholders' pictures were returned from the Louvre to the Mauritshuis, not all of them. But the Dutch Museum here was founded in the right wing of one of the former palaces of the family of Orange, here in an 18th century print. The National Art Gallery had to start with the leftovers of the collection of the family of Orange. So at first, the history of the House of Orange dominated in this museum. We know how the museum was arranged, as the curator, Waldorf, made drawings of the rooms. We also know that you only could visit the museum when you followed the tour guided by this Waldorf. He started the tour in the rooms and cabinets on the right and ended in the middle of the palace in the Orange Room, here, dedicated to the memory of the 17th century stadtholder Frederick Henry. It was somewhat ironic that the main part of the Batavian Museum was devoted to the hated tyrants of the Ancien Régime. The Batavian Republic was rather poor, as it had to pay millions to France, but it nevertheless tried to change the content of the museum and redress the balance by purchasing portraits of opponents of the House of Orange, like the threatened swan. This painting was at the time considered to be an allegory of Grand Pensionary Johan de Witt, or White in English. De Witt was head of state in the middle of the 17th century in Holland, in a period during which the Orange stadtholders were not in power. Words had been added in the 18th century to make it an emblem of Johan de Witt, and de Witt was an outspoken enemy of Orange. In the National Art Gallery, two rooms were dedicated to Dutch history, and three rooms and some cabinets were dedicated to art. This is the first history room, and here the swan was hung next to portraits of admirals, like the one of Michiel de Ruyter, left, upper left. However, we do know that some years later, the museum director moved the picture with the swan from the history room to the art room. Clearly, he didn't believe the interpretation of the swan as being Johan de Witt. So the painter Esselijn made this picture in the 17th century most probably as just an animal picture. In the 18th century, letters, words were added to make the swan the representation of Johan de Witt. And in 1800, the picture was purchased, the first acquisition of the National Art Gallery, because it was thought to represent an enemy of the family of Orange. But soon it was hung between the other pictures with animals and still lives, and as a work of art, and still is presented now in the Rijksmuseum as a work of art. Here is the drawing of the second room with history, so-called monument room, that was dedicated to Dutch history. Some of the objects in this room were called national relics. They had been part of the collection of the stadtholder. Here you see them handed over by the French occupiers to the Batavian Republic. They found their way, you see the cannon on the right, and they're also on the left, you see, handed over to the Dutch, to the Batavian Republic. And at the time, they were thought to have belonged to Admiral Michiel de Ruyter, the most famous of Dutch naval heroes. However, the portrait of the admiral was in another room, the first room. So these objects were not shown together. It was not very historically correct. This is one of the strangest examples of changes in objects in the Rijksmuseum. So the, let me show you. The cannon and the other weapons were made for the King of Kandy in Sri Lanka, The cannon was used to welcome visitors to the king, but the Dutch had seized the splendid cannon and other weapons as booty during a military campaign in 1765, when the palace of the King of Kandy was conquered. And they were presented to the stadtholder William V for his cabinet of rarities. However, in the catalog of the National Art Gallery in 1801, they were presented as presents from the Emperor of Tunis, whoever he might have been, to Michiel de Ruyter. Okay. There came a complete change during Louis Napoleon, and he moved the museum to Holland. But this is only to show you how small the part in the palace was that was dedicated to the museum. And here you see the two, what was strange, two national art museums. And this I have to tell you. In 1825, there was a rearrangement of objects in the museums, and the three-dimensional object had to go to The Hague. And the director said that these objects are not important. They are only important if you believe that they are authentic. And so clearly the director at the time did not think they were authentic. So they were moved to The Hague. And they were shown in the cabinet of rarities on the second floor of the Mauritshuis. And also a very small part of this cabinet, this museum in The Hague. And then they were moved back to Amsterdam. Here's the first floor, and here is the ground floor, and only the turquoise parts are history department. The rest is applied art and paintings. And now they are in the room that's called the Netherlands Overseas. Michiel de Ruyter is not mentioned anymore, but discussion is being taking place whether these objects should be returned to Sri Lanka. And here, the Michiel de Ruyter's portrait is in the room that's called Naval Power. And here, Massey would have been right if he had talked about Dutch chauvinism and triumphalism, but not in the first room where the Waterloo room. Here you can say that. And the Asselijn Swan is in the Gallery of Honor as a work of art. And that was my story. Thank you.